Welcome to the first episode of arXe-physics. Each day, many new physics papers are being uploaded to archive.org, the primary distribution system of physics texts prior to their publication in journals. One of them, uploaded several months ago, got some special attention. It was not only the unusual idea suggested in the title that was surprising, but also the personality of the author who suggested it. The author, Edward Witten, is an iconic figure in modern theoretical physics and particularly in string theory. For those of you who haven't heard about this field, let us say for now that it is a notoriously hard to grasp and mathematically heavy branch of physics. Most of Witten's papers are so abstract that they are hardly accessible even for many professional physicists. This paper, however, is not about string theory. All of a sudden, Witten decided to write a paper about something extremely down to earth. Well, not exactly down to earth, more down to solar system. Let's directly get to the heart of the subject. So you all know that our solar system has the sun at its center and planets revolving around it. Beyond the known planets, there are numerous minor objects floating in space, pieces of ice and rock, collectively known as the Kuiper Belt. Overlapping with this belt, larger bodies, called extreme transneptunian objects, revolve around the sun. In recent years, astronomers have discovered an anomalous behavior among the trajectories of objects in this belt. While this anomaly is still a subject of active scientific research, even with its existence being disputed, the most compelling explanation of it so far seems to be the existence of an unobserved planet, the so-called Planet 9, conjectured by Brown and Batygin. There are several speculations about the nature of this Planet 9. It could, of course, be a planet similar to other known planets, either directly formed in our solar system or captured from outside. A more exotic suggestion is that this object is actually a black hole, and not a simple one, but primordial. Let's clarify this last point. There are two main ways for black holes to form. The typical mechanism assumes the black holes to be formed at the end of the lifespan of massive stars. The nuclear processes in the star keep it from imploding under its own gravitational force. So, when the star depletes its nuclear energy, it collapses and forms a black hole. As you can imagine, such black holes are expected to be at least as heavy as stars. Planet 9, on the other hand, is estimated to be only 10 times heavier than our Earth, so it's very light to be formed from imploding stars. The second possibility, proposed by Soviet cosmologists Zaltsevich and Novikov, and later studied in detail by Stephen Hawking and Bernard Carr, is the black hole formation right after the Big Bang. This second mechanism is conceptually different from the first one, and while we will discuss it in later episodes, let us just emphasize here that this mechanism allows black holes to be as light as fractions of a gram. This means that if Planet 9 is indeed a black hole, then it should be a primordial black hole. Anyways, all this is to say that this Planet 9 could be a very interesting object, and it is worth studying it in detail. Witten is proposing a very simple idea. On a side note, the words Witten and simple do not usually go together, so make sure to take this chance and enjoy this moment fully. Witten is suggesting to send a spacecraft directly to the vicinity of Planet 9 and measure, for example, the strength of its gravitational pull. You might wonder if this could even be feasible in the foreseeable future. After all, the farthest traveled human-made object is the Voyager 1 spacecraft. In its 42 years of operation, it has managed to reach somewhere here, while Planet 9 is expected to be somewhere here. It would take more than a human lifespan, and only slightly less than it took us to complete this first episode, for Voyager 1 to reach the hypothetical location of Planet 9. Witten is suggesting to use spacecrafts. No, smaller than that. Even smaller. Even more. Just a little bit more. That's about right. Because these are tiny, they could be accelerated by powerful laser beams to very high speeds, as high as about 1,000th of the speed of light. This is not a result of Witten's vivid imagination. It is actually a project under consideration by breakthrough initiatives, with the goal to send the first man-made object to the nearest star outside the solar system. Back to Witten's paper, we currently don't know where exactly Planet 9 is located, so we don't really know in which exact direction we should send the spacecrafts. Witten is suggesting to send a cloud of about 1,000 of these tiny spacecrafts. Some of these would be able to approach Planet 9 very closely and could be affected by the planet's gravity. This is exactly the essence of the proposal. The tiny spacecrafts would travel in straight lines when not affected by any massive objects. On the other hand, the ones coming into close proximity to Planet 9 would travel in slightly altered trajectories. Imagine now that all these spacecrafts would send radio signals back to Earth with constant time intervals. Because of the small changes in trajectories of some of these space insects, the arrival times of their signals will be slightly shifted compared to the signals from the unaffected ones. Witten points out that there are a number of things that complicate this story. What you see here is a highly exaggerated view of the real shifts. In reality, the anticipated change in time that each signal takes to travel from a spacecraft to Earth is tiny, only 100,000th of a second. This means that very precise timing apparatus would have to be placed on board of the tiny spacecrafts, which of course would be a major technological challenge. Also, the cost of the project is estimated to be more than $500 million. Anyways, besides the technical and logistical challenges, it should at least in principle be possible, right? Well, a paper by Witten could hardly pass unnoticed. So soon there was a follow-up paper which points out several important gaps in Witten's analysis. Stay tuned.